Yeah, we'll just play the presentation. I hope it goes the right screen. Can you see the title?
Yeah, functional effect.
And not my cheat sheet. So let me see. Okay, the title. Okay, so great. So I think we can get started. So basically, the idea for the presentation came after my visit to Scala conference in Slovenia. It was B-Scala. I don't know if any one of you have been there, but nevertheless, it was very small group of people actually talking about Scala and mostly about, of course, functional side of Scala. And one of the hot topics, and I would say the most common discussed, was the Zio library. And my initial idea was to present the Zio as a Zio, but at the end, when I was actually doing the, let's say, research myself, preparing, and actually before that, I actually think that the grand knowledge about what is an effect, what is an effect system, about pipes and all this kind of stuff that lets us build this, let's say, effect system library, I think this is very crucial to get it first. So at this presentation, I will actually focus on the surroundings, and I will also I'll also touch on the Zio, but in a sense that I will only present, I call it a mental model. So it won't be like reassemble the library. It works the same as Zio, but it's actually a mental model just to understand how actually Zio does what it does. So the thing is that I will probably do if there are people of interest in this subject, I can do actually a second presentation focused only on Zio. And this will be more like, you know, how to use it, what are the scenarios to use it, and what are the nice tricks that you can actually do with it. But this is not like, it won't be part of this presentation, so it will end up on this mental model. So I hope everyone is fine with this. If yes, we can actually get started. Yeah, so first, like, what do we have to cope with to understand this? I mean, this is at least my understanding of this. So we should know, of course, what is a type and type system, what is an effect, and of course, an effect system, what are the effect types, and what does it mean that the program is effectful? So I think those are the base concepts. Of course, it will be scratch surface, yeah. So the first thing, this is taken from the Wikipedia, like an official definition, but let's just go through it and see if we actually understand it. So of course we use, probably most of us use types, and we know that types actually can somehow set rule for expressions and for constructs in a computer program. So for example, a construct can be a variable, and the constraint can be, okay, it's an int variable. It's a float variable, whatever. A construct, other construct can be expression, can be a function, can be any kind of thing that we know from programming languages. So basically a type system defines a set of those rules that we can actually apply to types. And it also somehow tracks how the types change and how they evolve during the program to check actually if the program makes sense. Basically, so it's able to actually see this information, use it to actually reduce possibility of bugs, of course, because you cannot assign variable to incompatible types, and so on. So I think this is quite clear. So type system actually is something that can use the type information that we use in our constructs in the programming language to formalize over the program and to check if it actually makes sense and it can be computed by, it can be executed. So analogous to type and type system, and an effect system is something that type system is for types. So effect system is actually, again, some kind of formalization that can describe computational effects of the computer program. So the thing is that, I mean, in a more abstract way, a program, of course, does a lot of effects, not sub let's say, side effects that we like most are familiar with, but let's say just a simple effects. So like what it does, it affects how the computational part of the program behaves. So as you can see, the sample effect is, for example, assigning a null to a variable. This is also an effect in the program. Effect is also throwing exceptions, for example. And effect is calling some API, of course. It's doing some thread operation and so on. So the effects are a very generic term for describing all the things that can go, that program does. So what it computes and how it computes. And actually the effect system can be used as it says also from the, this is from the Wikipedia, the first sentence actually in the Wikipedia. It can actually use the effect information that we have or don't have in the program to also check if the effects are somehow managed, if the effects can be optimized, if the effects can be even skipped sometimes. So it's also like a formal way of me as a programmer and the program telling the system that I know what I'm doing, and you can actually use this information to optimize my program. So not, of course, not every programming language has a strict effect system. For example, in Scala, the classic example is actually of an effect system is an exception. So we have checked exceptions in Scala. So this is somehow, if you say your function throws an exception, this is actually you saying, okay, I know this effect of my computational program does something, and please use this effect information that I'm providing you and do the whole formalization around it. So in case of Java, it would be actually that you have to somehow catch this exception, and you cannot actually run this program without doing so. So the effect system in case of checked exception in Java is quite strong. Of course, you can like propagate to the runtime exception and so on, but this is not the case in this example. So as you can see, there are also works in your research that would like to have use this effect system information to ensure that, for example, a program does not have any concurrent problems and doesn't have deadlocks or something like this. So it's still in the research phase. It's, as we know, in Java, it's actually doesn't exist. In Scala, it's like we have Scala community has more of those informations, but still it's not enough actually to do this kind of very deep reasoning about the program. Yeah, so basically I think this should be quite clear. So what is an effect type? So as we said before, an effect can be actually expressed either in types, as we do in functional programming, or with some language constructs that we have, for example, in Java. So we have throws in the method signature. It doesn't go into the somehow, let's say, type of the function, but at the end, it's also like a way to say that we can actually that it has an effect. But at the end, what we are interested in is the effect that are embedded in types. So looking at the type of the function or expression or whatever that we have in the whatever construct we have in the language, we know what effect it can actually do and it performs. So examples of the effect types could be actually try. So I guess everyone is familiar with. I would jump maybe from Java to Scala a little bit because I don't want to focus only on Scala. So we have in Java, there is a nice library actually after Java Slang, now it's called WAV. It has all those, it's very, very inspired by Scala actually. So at the end, it has very similar semantics and data types actually to describe the effects. So we have try, we have optional, that is also in the standard lib right now. We have either, we have IO as well, and any others that you can think of. So I think there are definitely more, of course. Depends on the library, depends on the what do you use in your programming toolset. So at the end, yeah, effect types are just types and effects encoded in types. So this is what we should take out of this page. And effectful programs, this is just a simple definition. So those are just programs that are performing. And now you see that I actually restricted it to side effects, because this is what we, let's say, are the most interested in doing our programming daily jobs. So the side effects, which I will explain in a minute, are, the cornerstone of those FX systems. So effectful programs are just programs that are performing some kind of FX, especially side effects. This is what we, if you look at the blogs or whatever, I think internet blog posts, you will find effectful program referring to programs performing side effects. Yeah, so side effects being a special case of an effect, computational effect, is just the effect that actually interacts with outside world, let's say. This is also a common term used in this describing this term. So as you can see, examples are printing on the screen, yeah, because it actually involves some kind of standard output interactions, which is not very, let's say, yeah, we'll get into that, but at the end, this is just a side effect. Even getting system time is actually a side effect, because it's also like interacting with some kind of outside world, computer unit designed to get to track the time. Reading files, REST calls, database operations, all those things are examples of side effects. So, and if we actually want to get from the effects, side effects, and to functional effects, we need to remind ourselves, like very briefly, what does functional programming stands for. So this is like my quick summary. Also, this is not a detailed explanation, but I think this is enough for this talk. So functional programming is all about, let's say, functions. So we pass functions, we compose functions. We can actually, of course, execute functions at the end. And what we care about is the properties of the function. So we want the functions to be total. So let's say for every input, they return an always the same output. This is like a nice property to have. We want them to have to be deterministic. So we want for the same input to get the same output always. Don't want this to be changed actually during our execution of the program. So we also would like to have no side effects actually. So we would like functions to return only the value and not interact with anything else. Of course, this is an idealistic view, but at the end, this is what we would like to have. And we would also like what functional programming uses is actually the referential transparency. So if those properties are met, especially the totality property, then we can actually substitute the call of the function call, a call with the function body, and the results should be the same. So it means actually that we could use like techniques that are called like a substitution principle. And this is also like used to reduce program size sometimes, or see if there's some, let's say, dead code or something can be call optimized or something like this. But at the end, this is what we care about. So we would like to have a function body that could be actually put into the, can be the function call could be replaced with the function body, and it should be the same. So we shouldn't see any additional effects in our program. So having that said, now we are at the functional effects. So the functional effects are somehow emerge of the, let's say, effects, computational effects, effect types, and functional programming. What it actually means is that functional effects have those properties that we actually described before. So the functional effect types are we can compose them. So if you have one effect, we can say, okay, using this result, please do something else. And this is how we can actually compose those. I will show you an example in a minute of the composition, but this is just the property that we would like to have. And to understand like a functional effect, we should actually see it as a data structure. So I don't know, a simple example could be actually a try, let's say, try effect. Maybe not a very, very functional, pure effect, but at the end it fits the purpose. So what we do actually with the try, we just modify, let's say, the structure and the effects that this data structure describes. So if we have, for example, reading from the standard input effect in a try, then we can map over this effect. We can modify, we can actually act on a result of this computation. So we can say, okay, I read something, the type of the return is string, so okay, I will do something with this value. But doing so, we only describe the operations. We are not executing anything at any point. So we are just, let's say, defining the structure of our program. And functional effects usually also use monadic data types. So for those of you who are not familiar with, let's say in the simplest way, monadic data type means that actually it can be nicely composed. So it can be mapped over. So like the example I described with the console, so we can call a map function on this type. And actually I can call let's call it in English. Twin brother of map, it's called a flat map, which I can say, okay, take a result of this operation, previous operation, and perform another operation of the same type. So I could say, okay, try gave me a string, so I can say flat map and take the string and perform probably another call that gets wrapped into the try effect type. So this is actually what we would like to have, because monads give us a composed, let's say, side of the effect. And as I said, like we only describe what we would like to do. We are not executing it. So this means that if we construct our program using the functional effects, we only get when we look at the type of what we get a type of kind of the description of the effect that we did. But in order to get the results of the whole computation, we need to actually interpret this. And interpreting is referred as the end of the word. So it means actually, okay, this is the time I would like to have my results back. I need it. So let's just execute the whole effect. Yeah, so next, what I would like to show you is actually example implementation of an effect, of a functional effect that does have those properties as that we talked about. So it can actually describe a computation that we would like to do, performing side effects. We can compose it, and at the end we can call the interpretation method. So end of the word execution. So let's see how can we actually do it. This will be actually Scala code, but I think I can explain it I hope it's actually understandable. So what we have actually here is, this is the tricky part, let's say. I hope I can actually do this. This cursor working. Sorry. Okay, I cannot actually get the cursor actually on the text. Okay, but at the end, what we have actually, there's a lot of concept, but let's say we have the computation that we want to perform. So this is our unsafe interpret. So this is just a function that takes no parameters but returns a value. And we wrap it in a let's say data type that is called IO in this case, which is, should be very familiar to you all. So which is it used to actually describe this, I think the most commonly used FX system to describe input output operations. So we have an IO class that actually takes our computation, which is a function from nothing to just a value that we want to return. And we have two methods on this data type. So we have a map, which takes actually the result of this operation that we passed in and produce another result. And we have a flat map, as I told you. So this is, it takes a result of this first operation and produces another instance of this IO. And we have a small helper method, which is called in effect. And this syntax, actually, for those of you who are not familiar with this F semicolon equals higher sign, this is actually by name passing parameter in Scala. It means that what we pass here won't be evaluated till we call it. So this is like mental model of this. This is like a lazy, let's say, parameter to a function. So in this case, we are not executing anything. We are just wrapping it into this IO, let's say, construct that we built. So what we are doing, you see, this new IO function from nothing to our effect, which at the end will be called. And we have two functions, actually. So this is a functional effect or effect system hello world. In this case, there's usually a console application written to show how you can actually construct programs without executing it. So as you see, we have two functions. There's a print put string into the console, which takes a line and just wraps it in the, doesn't execute it, just describes it. So it describes an effect of printing a line to the standard output. And we have a second function that describes an effect of reading a line from the standard output. So all the types, if we look at the types actually that we have for those functions, we can actually, let's say, track the effect of the computation. So in the first case, we see this is an IO effect. So this is some kind of input output effect, but it does not return anything. It just does something and that's it. The unit type means just doesn't return anything. And the get string line is actually, as you can see, again, IO, but it does return a string. So look, just by looking at the types, you can actually see what do we get in return. And now let's say the beauty part is actually that you can actually construct simple programs, let's say, with this small data types that we defined and functions of the data type. So we can say, okay, we have a program that this for and yield, this is also like a syntactic sugar in Scala. That's why you have to have those map and flat methods to use it actually in this way. But at the end, what you do is just we print something to the line, to the standard input, we read the answer and put it again to the standard output. And what we get in return is actually we return the input that the user actually provided in the standard input. So as you can see, this program is just the description of this computation, doesn't do anything. And this, those properties that we talked about, so being referential transparent, this holds for this. So I could actually take this for expression inside that we have. And in any case, I have this actually in my program, I could actually use this body of the function and it wouldn't actually change a thing, because still this would be a description of the effect that we want to perform. So this is a very, very nice property actually that holds for those functional effects. I mean, there is a side note for this. I mean, there is a a type in the effect type in the standard Scala library, which is called future, which at the end doesn't hold the referential transparency property, because at the moment you define the future, it actually already starts executing. So it's not like like we have here, what lazy, let's say lazy deferred execution, it actually starts executing. So you can imagine actually that exchanging the function body with the anywhere in the program would not work the same as it would for this one, because we would already would have like a, let's say, executed effect in this in the future type. So that's why this actually holds let's say better guarantees for us. It's simple modeling that we did actually with just a case, just a class, and then the helper method is enough to describe a very, very complicated, let's say, programs. And at the end, what we talked about already is like, okay, I have a description, but I want to get a value, so please execute this. So at the end, we just call the unsafe interpret, which is because we did some maps and flat maps, it's just the composition of the functions that we provided to the IO type. So at the end, yes, it would return probably the answer that we got. It would definitely return the answer that we provided in the standard input. Yeah, so this is, let's say, a basic model for functional effect. And now let's see how Zio actually defines those functional effects, because as you can see here, our IO only allows us to see by the type what do we get in return. So, and also with this our naive implementation, it doesn't actually allow us to pass anything to the initial effect. So it's just the just a function that just returns something, doesn't take any, let's say, arguments by default. So at the end, what Zio actually came up with is a very neat actually type that I introduce. So this is a real type. This is not like a fake or something. This is just a real type. So what they do have here is actually they have three type parameters. So one is R, which stands for environment. The second is E, which stands for exception. That can be thrown by this side effect, and the third one is A, which is actually a value that effect will return if it succeeds. And now the environment. What is an environment actually? For those of you who are familiar with the reader monad is actually something that let's say takes an initial argument. It can be a service. It can be some kind of config object, and pass that into the function that does the effect, the effectful operation, and reader returns just the result value of the effectful operation. So the type of the reader would be reader, and would be R and A. Wouldn't have the error channel that we see here in Zio. It would just have an R and A. So this is actually, let's say, even more comprehensive description of our effect. So the environment, as I told you, this can be a service, for example, a DB service that we need to have actually in order to call insert operation into our database. And E can be a SQL exception, and A can be a list of entities or the SQL return code or something like this. Those can be embedded into the type. And what Zio also does is actually it allows you to use it without the environment. So if you put any in the type instead of R, you say, okay, my effect does not require any environment. So you can call it however you want. And E is, as I told you, this is an error channel. So this actually shows you what error type your effect can may fail with, and it can be a custom data type, it can be a throwable, just a generic exception, can be any subclass of throwable, whatever you wish to have here. There's no restrictions for that. And A is just the success value, as I told you. And there also nice thing that you can actually express with this type, let's say, if you put, instead of error channel, you put nothing, which is actually a special type in Scala, you are indicating that the effect cannot fail at all. So this is just an effect that, for example, throws exception unexpectedly. So you would have like a, let's say, zero, and you in the inside the function that you pass to the zero type, you throw exception. So at the end, from the point of view of the types, you're doing just something that is totally unexpected. Yeah? You have not expected that, and you are doing it explicitly. And A, if you can put actually for A nothing again, this means that your effect doesn't end at all. So it means it can actually reflect a constantly forever running computation. So for example, I don't know, you could have some kind of scheduled execution, and you could just wrap it in this zero type saying, okay, nothing is returned, and this would indicate that this just runs forever. Yeah, so this is basically what zero proposed for the description of the effect. So environment, error, and successful value type. And what is good to notice here, actually, if some of you know other libraries from Scala ecosystem like CATS or Scala Z, but what is nice actually here is that Zio has, let's say, what they call as a polymorphic error channel. So usually in the effect types, you, for example, if you consider try, standard try type, you are restricted to throwable exception type. You cannot like say, okay, this is like an IO exception or whatever. Explicit in the type, of course, you can say recover, you can check the type of the exception and so on, but you cannot actually say this is actually an IO exception. And having that said, actually having that in the type is very nice for the compiler and actually for the IDE at the end to give you hints on operations that you can do with this effect type. So if you would say, okay, map error, there's a function called map error in Zio. So you could say, okay, map error, but it would give you a precise description of the exception type that you would get actually in this method. So you would say, okay, map error, and you would get IO exception. So this is very, very powerful property in Zio, which distinguishes from the other, let's say, effect systems. And also the environment is also something that is quite new, that is new in Zio, that is not present in the other effect systems by default. Yeah, there are some data types that you can do this with, but it's not like a default. And the Zio actually, this type can describe a lot of different kind of effects. So it can describe also asynchronous effect. It can describe reoccurring effects. It can describe synchronous effects, of course, and many others that, yeah, that they thought about. So now what I would like to show you is actually that maybe it looks very, very complicated at first, but at the end let's try to make a small our custom implementation of Zio. So yeah, this is actually my screenshot, but yeah, the quality is not so good, but hope you can see it actually. So This is not like my invention. This was also part of the talk by John DeGaulle that was on B-Scala, and he showed very, very similar mental model of Zio, just to show how we can actually understand Zio and why it does things like it does. So at the end, as you can see, it's very similar to what we've seen with the previous IO implementation. So we have a, in our case, it was unsafe interpret. Here it's called run. And instead of having no input parameters, it takes an environment, as you can see. And it just returns an either of an error or of some kind of type of successful operation. So very simple, actually, let's say abstraction, but with all the properties of, let's say, functional composition and helper methods, of course, because without the helper methods, it wouldn't be possible. You can do really, really amazing stuff with this thing. So yes, at the end we have some helper methods on the companion object. There's a succeeded, which means, okay, as you, now it's, let's try this experiment to look at the types. So we see that the Zio has any as an environment, so it can take any environment. We don't care what environment is it. It is nothing. It means that it cannot fail. It always succeeds, and it always succeeds with type A. So this is like saying, okay, underscore is just any, and write is just a successful value for either. So this is very simple implementation, but the types give you actually enough hints to, let's say, to almost get this implementation right. And now the fail, let's say companion method for the succeed is very similar. So you say, okay, looking at the types, we have any, so any environment, we fail with exception of type E, and we don't produce anything. So this is just saying, okay, the same but left value of either. Now there is a special construct actually to get the access to the environment. So you can say, okay, I want the environment. So this is what it does. So it gives you a new Zio with environment R as it was before. Nothing, because it cannot fail. This operation actually getting environment, it cannot fail because we have the environment already, and we produce the type of R. It looks maybe strange at the beginning, but of course you can do map, flat maps, and you can do different stuff on it, and then return, let's say, to the success channel or skip to the error channel. So you can actually move on the different, let's say, channels of the Zio type. So you could actually do operations on the environment, you can do operations on the exceptions and on the success. And what you can do actually is a nice feature, actually you can flip. So you can actually say, okay, now the error channel is my success channel. So you can actually do this kind of freaky operations. But this is what I wanted to show you actually, maybe on the next presentation, if there are enough volunteers or interested people in this. Okay, and the let's say like this terminal operation that we already mentioned before is just the die operation. Die means looking at the types. We don't care about the environment. We don't throw any. We just don't throw any exceptions, and we return nothing. So it means actually this is like a just throw exception, which terminates everything. So you cannot do, let's say, mapping on this, because you cannot map on nothing. Yeah, so this is like seeing the type, you already see that this is actually a end of your, let's say, composition. So it failed, basically. So this is actually for the mental model of Zio. There are of course more methods to the companion objects. A companion object is, which I did not put here, but there's an effect method which actually takes your computation and wraps it in the Zio. But the implementation is quite let's say intuitive. It's what it's doing actually. It's doing a regular try catch close, but it tries to do right of the computation, and if it fails, it just does left of the computation, of the exception that it got from the catch close. This is wrapping just a try catch with this Zio data type. And I think this is actually everything that I got for this for the second part of the presentation. And yeah, those are the useful links that I actually found that I think are worth reading or looking at. Let's say I'm kind of a upper beginner on this subject. This is the first project actually that I'm working on in right now that I'm using those libraries that I mentioned. So CATS and Zio, this is actually what the client is using. Previously, those were just, you know, theoretical readings and some experiments at home. But now I'm getting more and more, I think, familiar with the concepts. And yeah, as you know, from theory to practice is hard at the beginning, because you, I guess, you start what you do first, you just wrap everything with this IO, and you do four comprehensions in Scala, and you're happy that you are doing the let's say functional effects. You're using a functional effect system, but at the end it's actually finding the balance. Where is the business logic that allows actually for using those kind of things, and how can we improve the business logic with using those functional effects systems? So usually what I mean, if you look at Zio in your free time or whatever, maybe you're using already Zio, you see that there are many useful things for retrying operations, for scheduling operations, for concurrency. They have implementation of fibers, which Java will get soon as well. But they already have this kind of, let's say, software. I mean, a library kind of fibers. Of course, in Java you have also fiber library, but at the end there will be a standard Java language extension for fibers. But yeah, so. And also Java is, of course, getting more and more functional concepts into the system, into the ecosystem. So I guess if it will just get more and more common to use them. But at the end, where is the problem is actually the types that can express the FX types, because this is actually what most of the languages are aiming for. So types saying you what is going on in the function, and this is actually where Java is not that, let's say, performant as Scala and as Haskell, for example, where it all almost came from. So probably Java will just get something more reduced or something more cut to the business, let's say, cases than Scala has. So yeah. The first link is actually a very interesting one. This is just the guy says it's a proof of concept library for Java, but it seems very kind of mature already. So this is an IO functional effect implementation for Java. It takes a lot of inspirations from Scala, so it seems to be quite, let's say, thought through solution, and it's. From the examples and from the README files, you can get a lot of insights how it works and how it can be used. So it can do everything that we've seen here with this sample IO implementation that we got, and even more, because it has more stuff built in. It also, I think, supports asynchronous computation, so it's more powerful abstraction. Yeah. So the second link is actually the IO Monad presentation, how it was invented, why it was invented for. The third link is actually the presentation that I attended at the Scala conference, which is called Doing Magic Tricks with Zio. And I really encourage to see this presentation, because it's really nicely put, very simple words, and it shows a lot of stuff that you can actually do with Zio. And the second is actually the article, I think already famous one in the Scala community, that describes the motivation why the Zio was created and what was before Zio. So it also describes the IO effect that we've seen. It touches on the error channel, and it also describes the reader monad to some extent, and so on. At the end, it presents Zio as the, you know, ultimate solution. Of course, this is the author of Zio writing this article, so cannot be surprised by this conclusion, but at the end, Zio is, I think, very, very powerful, and I would say intuitive, in a sense that it does not require that much functional programming concepts as cats, for example, or Scala Z. So you don't have type classes here. You don't have like, polymorphic data types or polymorphic parameters, implicit parameters, whatever you mentioned from the, let's say, hardcore Scala functional world. Zio is much, much simpler, I would say. And the last one is just for reference to see, there's a nice description actually, motivations and what the IO monad, IO effect type monad in CATS can actually do and what it can describe. Yeah, so I think this is it. It took only not more than 15 minutes. This is what I was aiming for, 15 minutes. So I don't know if any one of you wants would like to share your thoughts or whatever you have on your mind. Please do.
Hi, it's Victor talking. I have one question. It's Zio concept very similar to completable future in Java for me, it seems.
Yes.
It looks like almost the same, but more
yes, complex. It's very, very similar. You're right. But the thing is that, let's say, completable future is intended for asynchronous operations. Or asynchronous computations mostly, and with Zio you can do this, let's say, fiber computations as well. You can do soon clustered computations, so it can, let's say, it's a more generalized way of saying of describing. I mean, a computable future is just a subset of Zio, let's say. Yeah, so with Zio you could actually make your own effect type, which would be very or even similar to computable future. So I would say this is it, and Zio also, I mean, this is good that you mentioned, because Zio also has type aliases that simplify the Zio type that we've seen. This is the full type, but it also has a type alias for IO, it has a type alias for task, and so on. So it can be simplified actually to fit the one purpose only. So, but you're right, this is very similar, and I think this, if you look at the, let's say, broader concept, it's mostly those effect systems are very similar. So you just pass a tank, let's say a function that does the computation, and just wrap it in your data type.
So if I may add a comment.
Yes.
Completable futures example of the effect, and Zio is like library for all these effects of different types, and completable future might be one of the functional effect example.
Exactly.
It also probably follows the monadic features, so it's just an example of such effect.
Okay, so
guys, do you have more questions to Michal?
Just out of the curiosity, if you could show the code example with IO that you have on the slide.
You mean the in the code base or in the okay, yeah, this one.
Before introducing Zio type.
Yeah, that's sorry. Yes, this one.
The first line, there is S lambda. I don't follow this syntax. What does it do? The first line.
Yeah, this is a nice thing actually. This is actually an self type alias. So this is like a this.
Okay. No, yeah. I got it.
Like with the traits. Yeah.
Yeah. Sure.
Yeah, it's a very uncommon. Also, seen a couple of times only.
I forgot many times it's alias as self.
So yes. It's exactly.
As a S.
Okay, so if there are no more questions, then I think we can conclude here. Of course, this is like a scratch of the surface. Yeah, I probably omitted a lot of stuff. Hopefully, the grand actually building blocks were there. But of course, the effect systems and the libraries that we have are much more complex than what I described, but at the end, I think the concept is maybe not simple, because it's not that simple, as probably not many of us, or I don't know, would write this kind of reasoning in code. But at the end, it's if you have the intuition, I think it's not that difficult to use it. You just have to have the proper project, let's say, to play with it.